Let's pray. God, we come. We thank you for your spirit that shows up in power. God, we thank you, God, that we don't have to catch you. For when we say yes to your son, God, that your spirit took up residence in our place. So, God, we thank you for the Holy Ghost, your spirit that dwells in us, moving down in our soul, encouraging us, empowering us, giving us hope. God, we thank you. Now, God, it's time for us to hear your word. God, we pray that you would speak to us, that you would preach to us, that you would teach us, that you would convict us, you would challenge us, encourage us, give us hope and direction. So, God, we ask that you give us ears to hear, give us a heart to receive, and a will to do. To the end, God, that a soul might be saved and a heart might be changed. We thank you right now. We need you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, yes. Bless me now.
Me now, my Savior.
I come to thee. Amen, amen. Our God is faithful. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, electronic device, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Amen. Sometimes you just got to go back a little bit. Amen. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. So we praise the Lord that you know, we got some folk who can retch back.
That's right.
You know, to some of them old songs. Yeah, I said retch. You know, some of us, it's pretty reaching. You know, when you reach, it's pretty. When you retch, you ain't afraid to get a little dirty. Amen. You ain't afraid to reach back through your pain and grab a hold to the Holy Ghost. Amen. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Amen. And this is what the Word of God says. I'm reading from the Holman Contemporary Standard Bible. It says this: all Scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. I also love how the New Living Translation puts it. It says this: all Scripture is inspired by God and useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out and teaches us to do what is right. It is God's way of preparing us in every way, fully equipped for every good thing God wants us to do. Amen. So if you need a title for today, as we are starting this new year off with our series, Committed, Amen. Today we're talking about the fact that we need to be committed to God's word. Committed to God's word. Listen, in this information age, it's all about sound bites. Amen. That's why we got that problem with, President-elect talking about the fake news. Amen. Because everybody, we grab a hold of a sound bite and we want to base everything off sound bites. Uh-huh. We want our info fast and we rarely think about its reliability.
Right.
See, some of us still live by our daily newspaper. Amen. I was surprised when Miss Sunday said, I still want my paper. Amen. She was sharing with me. We like our newspapers. We still like our favorite magazines. We find articles, those articles, informative, and many people shape how they see the world by what they read and see in the news, in different media. We shape what we see on based on what we know about TV and movies and music. Many of us would deny it, but it's evident by how we live. We are shaped by the culture. See, through the internet, social media, and TV, we are in touch with the world. However, if we take some time to really examine our lives, we will see a life that resembles the world, or will we see a life that resembles Christ? See, it comes down to what's your source. Amen. You ask any good folk, any good news person, they'll tell you if your source is no good, then the story probably is no good. See, what's your source? It helps shape how you look at life. What's your source is what you filter and run every decision of life through. What's your source? See, for Christians, that source has to be the Word of God. See, for Christians, we have to commit to knowing and adhering to the source, the Word of God, the Bible. Amen? So if you need a driving principle for today as we spend time learning what we need to do to be committed to God's Word is this. Christians must commit to God's Word. It is God's training manual for living a faith-filled, fulfilled life. Now, don't let that be a tongue twister for you. Amen? Christians must commit to God's Word. It is God's training manual for living a faith-filled, fulfilled life. Amen? So why is it that so many of us would rather read social media news articles than verses in the Bible? Why would we spend more time reading on politics, sports, and or fashion than reading the guidebook for life? Well, John MacArthur has an answer for us. In his book, Think Biblically, he asserts that many who claim to be Christians do not believe that the Bible is truly sufficient enough to deal with today's complex problems. You know, I guess God's Word can't handle the complex. He states, many Christians seem to assume that the Bible needs to be supplemented with other sources. We now have churches where entertainment and experiences take center stage. No longer are Bible study, teaching, and applying the Word of God sufficient to meeting people's spiritual needs. Evidence of this, he says, is seen in churches where preaching is being replaced with entertainment, and Christian bookstores are full of books to address every kind of human experience with extra biblical techniques. MacArthur concludes that when believers read, study, obey, and apply Scripture, they will realize it has sufficient power to deal with any situation. Amen. See, I propose to you this morning that as Christians, we must commit to God's Word. It's not optional. We must commit to read it, to study it, to obey it, and apply it. See, the Bible is God's training manual for His church and for His people. So let's paint the picture a little bit. Let's get a little context. As the Apostle Paul was penning this letter to his young protege, Timothy. So in this epistle or this letter, we find the Apostle Paul writing to his son in the faith, Timothy. At this time, Paul had been imprisoned by the Roman Emperor Nero and knew the end of his life was coming near. Amen? He knew that his journey here on earth was wrapping up. And in this second letter to Timothy, he pours out his heart to Timothy and encourages him regarding the course that Timothy is about to take. In chapter 1, Paul reminded Timothy to retain the standard of sound words and to guard the treasure that has been entrusted to him. Listen, in 2 Timothy 1, verses 13 and 14, he says this, "Hold on to the pattern of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard through the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, who lives in us, that good thing entrusted to you." Timothy, you've been given a jewel. Take care of the jewel you've been given. Amen? He goes on in chapter 2. He encourages his young protege to entrust the things he has learned from Paul to faithful men. He told him to endure hardship like a faithful soldier. He reminded him, listen, that a faithful soldier doesn't get entangled up into the things of the world. Then he goes on to tell him, listen, I need you to compete like an athlete. An athlete that follows the rules. Amen. And not only that, he said, I need you to be like a hard-working farmer. See, because a hard-working farmer, when he plants the crops, he knows that not only will those crops benefit others, but he gets the benefits from the harvest. Amen. See, he's encouraging Timothy. He told Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15, he told him, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who doesn't need to be ashamed, correctly teaching the word of God. See, he knows what Timothy's getting ready to deal with. Amen. As he's passing the mantle on to Timothy, this young pastor, amen, he is allowing him and giving him a charge to be able to stand fast in difficult times. In chapter 3, we find Paul warning Brother Timothy about the difficult times ahead. He writes in 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 5, he says this, but know this, difficult times will come in the last days. See, he's not missing words. For people, just see if this sounds familiar to you. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents. Y'all hear that, kids? Disobedient to parents. Ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, without love for what is good, traitors, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to the form of godliness but denying its power. Then he tells Timothy, avoid these people. See, this in the Bible. Amen. It's in the Bible. He goes on in verse 10 through 15 to tell him this, but you, Timothy, have followed my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, and endurance, along with these persecutions and sufferings that came to me in Antioch, in Iconium, in Lystra. What persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from them all. In fact, all those who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. See, he didn't have such a rosy word for Timothy. He had a word that was real, a word that encouraged them that no matter what, because you love Jesus, understand that persecution comes with the package. Yes, then verse 13, he says this, evil people and imposters will become worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you've learned and firmly believed. You know those who taught you. And you know that from childhood you have known the sacred scriptures, which are able to give you wisdom for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. See, Timothy was getting his pastoral charge from his mentor. Paul wanted to make sure that he gave Timothy an accurate picture of what it was to lead God's people and what he would face. And not only that, his dependence on God's word. And this brings us to our focus scripture today. So why is it important? Why is it that Paul brings Timothy to this point where he tells him all scripture is God-breathed and has purpose and benefit? Mm-hmm. See, in Paul's time, the teaching of Christ and the Old Testament scriptures would be in question. Amen. Doing my research, I was telling my wife it was quite disheartening to see how many God haters are out there. It was disheartening to see how many folk truly hate the word of God and try to undermine the scripture. Amen. It is no easy task to stand and proclaim God's word, but you have to know that this word has endured the test of time. Amen. So in Paul's time, the word was questioned. The word was under attack. Amen. Paul's teaching were under scrutiny. If you read his letters, he constantly reminds us that folks were questioning the fact that he was an apostle. Not only were the fact were they questioning that he was an apostle, they were questioning his authority to lead in the church. Amen. They talked about, listen, Paul's letters are weighty, but he looked a little weak in person. Amen. They were concerned about what the man looked like instead of what the man was saying. Amen. Yeah. His teachings under scrutiny, the word of God was under attack. Today, the Word of God is under attack. The reliability of Scripture is being undermined by scholars like those of the Jesus Seminar and scrutinized by armchair theologians across the world. People who claim, yeah, I know the Bible front, back, side to side, but they don't have the Holy Ghost inside them. Amen. See, the Scripture is being twisted to fit any lifestyle choices that fly in the face of the express Word of God. See, but check this out. One of the biggest dangers to Christians that believe that the Word of God is reliable comes from within. See, there are people in the pews today that don't believe the Bible is the inerrant and inspired Word of God. See, there are people who sit in churches Sunday after Sunday who don't believe the principles, practices, and doctrines that drip from the Word of God. They don't believe that the Bible is true. They come to the church, they lift up hands, amen. They'll sing songs, but they really don't believe. Amen. Just like I shared with you before, they got Burger King theology. They want to be able to pick and choose what they like about the Bible and discard the stuff that don't taste good. See, when we look at the Christians, listen, we must commit to God's word. It is God's training manual for living a faith-filled, fulfilled life. Amen. See, the first thing we see here in our focus scripture is that we must commit to God's word because it originates from God. Yes. See, this is not just 66 made-up books by 40 different authors, amen, that span some 4,000, that was started 4,000 years ago, amen, spanned over 2,000 years. This came from God. Because the scripture tells us, for listen again what it says, all scripture is inspired by God. See, the power of the Bible to affect change, amen, and demand obedience resides in the fact that all scripture comes from the one who sits on the throne. See, the Bible originates from God. Claims of origin carry great significance because authority lives in the Creator. Mm-hmm. See, the one who creates a thing has control over it. Amen, amen. You know, if you at home, if you make something, amen, it does not have authority over you. You made it. Amen. I love how the Lord puts it. He says, shall the created dictate to me? Amen. We are the ones that are created. He sits on the throne. When we look at this, it says that it is inspired by God. It literally means that it is God-breathed. It is God-breathed. The origin is from the Creator. This is why people invest so much time and effort in trying to disprove God as the earth's creator and questioning the authenticity of the Bible. Because if they can undermine his word, they think they can undermine his authority. See, listen, admitting to God's authority and authorship of the scripture is an acceptance of his authority over every aspect of life. See, once you recognize that the word of God comes from God, you have to accept his word, amen, and accept his position as the ultimate authority, amen. Listen, by stating the scriptures are God-breathed, Paul established that the Bible's claim as God's authoritative word over all people. God is in control, not us. Amen. See, God's word is true because it comes from a God who is true. I like how Warren Wiersbe writes this. He says, it is inconceivable that God would give his people a book they could not trust. For he is the God of truth. Jesus is the truth. And we have the spirit of truth. And Jesus said of the scriptures, thy word is truth. You see, when Paul wrote to Timothy, he was telling him that God inspired this word and it is true. All scripture is inspired. Listen, the flood happened. The Red Sea did part. The walls of Jericho did fall. Gideon's army of 300 were victorious over thousands. David did kill a giant named Goliath. Elijah did call down fire. A donkey spoke. And I'm not talking about your friend or family. Amen. A virgin had a baby. Amen. Jesus walked on water. The lame walked, the blind could see, amen. The Son of God hung on a cross, and a on the third day, he got up from the grave. Amen. And Christ is coming back. See, the word of God is true. These ain't made up stories. Amen. This is God's word, inspired by him. It is the scripture that tells us that God spoke, amen, and men actually wrote what God spoke. In the Old Testament, men were seen as his mouthpiece. He would speak through prophets, amen. And when the prophet would speak, he would say, "Thus saith the Lord," amen. And when it said, "Thus saith the Lord," those words that preceded, God would start to use personal pronouns. Amen. When God would speak, he says, "I am that I am." And who sent you, Lord? The I am sent you. Amen. It is God that is the one who breathes into those individuals and gives them his word. In the New Testament, we see the New Testament writers are inspired by God. They don't speak as oracles of God. They are inspired. God maintains their personalities. He maintains their speaking, their culture, amen, and he speaks through them. All scripture is inspired by God. God is the originator, amen, and we can commit to his word because it originates with him. Not only that, amen, when we look at it, because it is God breathed, amen, and because this is God's instruction manual for our life, we can commit to God's word because it is useful. Right. It's right there in the scripture. You don't believe me? It tells us that the word of God is useful, or as some would say, profitable, amen. As our scripture text write, profitable, and it can also be translated as useful. In modern culture, there seems to be a mix-up. There's a mix-up with what is meant by profitable. Right. Amen. When we turn on some of the so-called Christian programming and take a close look at some of the mega ministries, we could easily conclude that the word of God is for profit. But see, that's not what Paul is saying. Here he's talking about it's profitable for teaching, profitable for rebuke, profitable for correction, profitable for training in righteousness. See, the word of God is profitable. It's useful. So the word of God is useful for the believer and the church. See, it's useful for this, for teaching. First, we see this. Teaching involves instruction. It is amazing to me, as I digress for a minute, that how many of us as believers, we're allergic to being taught the word of God. Well. We'll go to school for 8 years to get a degree that might get us a job, that make a little money, amen? We want to raise up through our jobs. We'll study policy and procedure books meticulously, amen? And we'll be able to interview and spew to them verbatim what we learned from a book. But we don't want to get in God's word, amen? See, it involves instruction. Since Timothy was feeling the attacks of false teachers, Paul encouraged the young pastor to continue in teaching correct doctrine and correct living. I remember when we started this ministry and Miss Marilyn came aboard and she was starting our teaching, helping with our teaching ministry and established teachers training. And when they got the syllabus, when they found out 6 months, right. Man, Sunday till what time? 3 o'clock. Man, and they start looking at these doctrines and why we got to learn this and why we got to learn that. I know y'all wasn't saying it out loud. I read your spirit. Amen. You see your spirit. Amen. But what they had to understand is that this word is serious. And if you're going to stand up and teach in front of God's people, you need to understand what the word says. Amen. We ain't going to have you all willy-nilly up here preaching what you think and what you thought and what you feel. Amen. You need to be taught the doctrines, the principles, the practices of the word of God correctly. Correctly. Amen. Listen, the scripture must be known so people will grasp their need of salvation. And so that the confessing community will adhere to his instructions on proper Christian conduct. Yes. Listen, you won't say you haven't been taught. Amen. Listen, the only reason you can say that you haven't been taught because you haven't come. Right. Amen. Listen, and we don't mind if you audit. Amen. Y'all get that later on. Amen. You can audit a course, amen. But come on and get God's word. It's beneficial. It is useful. It is profitable for teaching. This is our main instruction manual, amen. The word of God. Not only is it useful for teaching, amen, it's useful for rebuking and correcting. All right, hey, can I sit down right here? Because I don't want to go through this part, Deacon. Amen. They are part of the rebuke squad. Amen. Listen, rebuking and correcting are the disciplinary authority of Scripture. I know we don't like talking about that part, amen, but I guarantee you on your job, every job has a disciplinary policy, amen, that must be adhered to kind of bring order so that folks ain't out of control. The Bible has that as well. See, because the Bible is God's word and because it reveals truth, it exercises authority over those who deviate from its standard. See, rebuking points out sin and confronts disobedience. See, a rebuke identifies sin and identifies disobedience. Now, let me break this down just a little bit, because some folk, you know, they want to be on the rebuke squad. Amen. Yeah. Jesus gives some very clear mandates, amen, on how we deal with other individuals, amen. We got some beam in the eye folks that's always quick to point out folks' stuff, amen. Listen, when we're talking about rebuke, this is done in love. This is done with the purpose to bring someone back to restoration. Listen, I know that we try to pretend, but some of us sin and don't even realize how deep we've gone in. But as brothers and sisters in Christ, it is our obligation, amen, to be able to rebuke in love. Yes, yes. In love. On Tuesday night at 7:30, as we study 1 Corinthians, we talked about the fact that we got into a little bit of church discipline. Amen, that the Bible tells us Jesus gave us a model for how we discipline. You, when you see someone caught in sin, you go to them one-on-one. You don't get on the phone and say, listen, I saw sister such and such, and she was doing this and doing that. We need to pray for her. Amen. Then you call the next one. Hey, can you go on the web, put sister such and such on our Facebook prayer list? Amen. That we make sure that she correct her behavior. No, if you see it, you go one-on-one. Then if she tells you jump off the cliff, amen, then you take another sister or another, if it's sisters, or another brother with you, amen, and then you go to them, get hold of them. And if they tell you both jump off, then the Bible says take it to the church. If you want to learn more about that, come Tuesday, 7:30, I'll be glad to go over it with you. So rebuking points out sin and confronts disobedience. But correcting recognizes that a person has strayed from the truth. Sometimes when we stray from the truth, it's not purposeful. Amen. You need to be reminded of what the standard says. Amen. It was just like on yesterday, the men got together and we started this book, Kingdom Men. Amen. And Tony Evans says that it's like in basketball, that every standard court, no matter where you go, is 10 feet. Amen. But what men today are doing is lowering the court so they can dunk. See, you can't lower God's standard so you can feel good about yourself. Amen. God has a standard. And when you start to stray from the standard, the word of God will correct your course. Amen. Listen, it recognizes when folks stray from the truth. But listen, graciously, lovingly, yet firmly, we should try to guide the errant individual back into obedience. Lovingly, graciously, recognizing that if we ain't careful, we'll be falling with them. Right. Listen, many times the Old Testament relates Israel's disobedience to God. See how the people suffered God's chastisement for their rebellion and how God corrected their sinful habits. The New Testament continues with stories and instructions, warnings regarding disobedience, disciplinary actions for those who fail to heed God's revelation, and teachings on proper conduct. See, we are charged Amen, to rebuke and correct. And the Word of God has the primary responsibility of doing that. Listen, you may avoid being rebuked and corrected by folks if you go and get in God's Word, because He'll rebuke and correct you Himself.
Amen.
See, not only is it useful for rebuking and correcting, it's also useful for training in righteousness. See, I love this. I love this. See, training in righteousness is the counterpoint to correction. Yeah. See, the scripture gives us positive guidance for maturing in faith and in acceptable conduct. See, the Bible trains or instructs us in the way of righteousness, the right path we are to take and to follow if we want to grow in godliness and holiness and light. I love how Psalm 119, 105 puts it. It tells us that your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Amen. Listen, when this illumination, this light upon our path, it goes through life. It comes from the many directives we have in the scriptures concerning different aspects of life. We often talk about, well, the Bible don't talk about that. Well, the Bible talks about a lot. Amen. And what the Bible talks about is enough to help guide and direct your life. Amen. It talks about what we deal with in life, our use of our time. It talks about family life, the use of money. Amen. It talks about how we rear up our children, how we raise our kids. It talks about marriage and sexual relations. Amen. I know we don't talk about that, but it's in the Bible. And it's for free couples, married couples. Amen. He wants you to have a fulfilled life in all aspects and enjoy every area of marriage. I don't know why that came to mind, but I thought I'd share that. Listen, in all these things, broad principles and guidelines are laid down which help to train us in the life of righteousness. Listen, it's like when you read the Word of God, one writer says this, J.I. Packer says this, it's like listening to good preaching. He says this, Holy Scripture should be thought of as God preaching. God preaching to me every time I read or hear any part of it.
Right.
He says this, God the Father preaching, God the Son in the power of God the Holy Spirit.
Right.
It's profitable for training in righteousness. We must commit to it because it is useful. Mm-hmm. And lastly, as I push to a close this, we must commit to God's word because it equips. It equips. Verse 17 talks about so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. See, the goal of this instruction, discipline, and training is not to keep us so busy that we forget about God.
Right.
See, God intends that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. See, we study the Bible, we rely upon God's Spirit, His revelation, and the community of the faithful to keep us on track, obedient and maturing in faith. Continuing in this commitment will enable us to do whatever God calls us to do. Listen, Paul primarily was when he said that the man of God, this pastor, would be equipped, but not only that the pastor would be equipped, but if we're in God's word, we all will be equipped. Every man and woman that names the name of Jesus, we will be equipped to do the work that God has called us to do. See, Timothy could withstand the attacks of false teachers, the teachers, the abandonment of professing believers, and the persecution that surrounded him because God had equipped him for the task.
Right.
Listen, often people are afraid to get busy for Jesus because they think, oh, well, you know, I wasn't trained for that. I didn't go to seminary. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. You have the very power of the Holy Spirit who has gifted you. Amen. We learn from the scripture that all of us have spiritual gifts. God will take your spiritual gifts, will take your personality, will take your experiences, and use them for the benefit of His kingdom. Amen? All of us have something to offer to kingdom work. See, God never calls us to do something without first enabling us through His Spirit and the power of His truth to accomplish the task. Listen, He'll never call you to something and leave you hanging. And I know some of us on our job, we've had experiences. The boss has asked us to do some stuff, and he said, just go do it. You're like, hey, boss, you ain't enabled me to do that. I don't know how to do it. You haven't equipped me to do that. You haven't trained me to do that. You haven't provided me with the resources to be able to do that. Listen, if God called you to it, he will give you everything you need to do it. Listen, it's the word of God. As one writer puts it, we neglect the scriptures at our own peril. It says, through them we gain the ability to serve God and others. The scriptures not only point the way through the mysterious union of God's word and faith, they give us the ability to serve. God's word. Listen, let me close with this. On tomorrow, we celebrate the birthday of the great Dr. Martin Luther King. Amen. His actual birthday, I believe, is today. But it's seldom mentioned that the word of God was foundational in the fight for civil rights. See, it was the word of God that was useful to equip a preacher to stand up to horrendous opposition.
Yes.
Let me share this, the conclusion from Dr. King's sermon based on one of the most famous passages from the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, verses 43 through 48. And it was titled, Loving Your Enemy. He preached this in 1957. It says this, so this morning as I look into your eyes, and to the eyes of all my brothers in Alabama and all over America and all over the world, I say to you, I love you. I would rather die than hate you. And I'm foolish enough to believe that through the power of this love, somewhere men of the most recalcitrant bent will be transformed, and then we will be in God's kingdom. It says we will be able to matriculate into the university of eternity, of eternal life, because we had the power to love our enemies, to bless those persons that cursed us, to even decide to be good to those persons who hated us. And we even prayed for those persons who despitefully used us. Oh God, help us in our lives and all of our attitudes to work out this controlling force of love, this controlling power that can solve every problem that we confront in all areas. Oh, we talk about politics. We talk about the problems facing our atomic civilization. Grant that all men will come together and discover that as we solve the crisis and solve these problems, the international problems, the problems of atomic energy, the problems of nuclear energy, and yes, the race problem, let us join together in a great fellowship of love and bow at the feet of Jesus. Give us the strong determination in the name and spirit of this Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, Dr. King was committed to the principles, the practices, amen, of the word of God. See, he held to these precepts. God used him to transform a nation. See, but listen, God may not have called you to change the world.
Right.
However, he has given you a purpose, and that is to glorify him with your life. And in order to live out that purpose, you have to commit to his word. You have to believe it. You have to trust it, you have to obey it, and you have to apply it.
Amen.
Listen, Christians, we must commit to God's word. It is God's training manual for living a faith-filled, fulfilled life. Listen, the word of God is God-breathed. And because he breathed it, we can believe it, and we need to commit to getting in it. Amen?
Amen.
Give God a hand of praise. Amen, amen. Our God is faithful.
Faithful.